Listen to the new Thin Green Line podcast wherever you listen to podcasts. Game Wardens John Norris and Wayne Saunders talk about wildlife, the outdoors, law enforcement, environmental subjects mixed with current events and guests that are part of the Thin Green Line. And if you are one of those visual people, like me, for $5 a month, you can see the actual podcast on Patreon.com. Just search the Thin Green Line podcast on Patreon.com and join us. The Copper Pig Brewery in Lancaster, New Hampshire, is brewing traditional and innovative high-quality beers, as well as serving a large menu of creative comfort foods appealing to all walks of life, with daily specials sourcing many ingredients locally. Charitable involvement and support of their community is a cornerstone to the Copper Pig Brewery's mission. Voted number one in New Hampshire by WMUR Viewer's Choice 2 years in a row, 2018 and 2019. Please join me at the Copper Pig.
We love our children. We protect them. We guide them. We prepare them for life in the world. With all that we do, from deep in our hearts, we cannot control all things. Life-threatening illnesses and disabilities affect far too many of our children each year. While we cannot change the circumstance, we can make dreams come true. Dreams to provide hope, to provide spiritual healing and strength, to provide moments of happiness and relief in the hardest of times. We can give a glimmer of light and hope in a time of darkness and despair. Join huntofalifetime.org to help make dreams come true, to provide hope for children with life-threatening illnesses and disabilities. Hunt of a Lifetime is a nonprofit organization fulfilling dreams for hunting and fishing trips to youth 21 and under with life-threatening illnesses and disabilities. Visit huntofalifetime.org to learn how you can make a difference.
This podcast is brought to you by Maine Operation Game Thief
and Wildlife Heritage, a foundation of New Hampshire, at nhwildlifeheritage.org
and
International Wildlife Crime Stoppers. Please join me, Game Warden Wayne Saunders, and other Game Wardens on our adventures protecting wildlife, saving lives, and having fun, all while serving the public and the natural resources of our planet. Listen to the tales and experience of those who work in the outdoors while being entertained with stories about encounters with poachers, wildlife investigation, murder investigation, near-death experiences, search and rescue missions, wildlife interactions from game wardens around the country and around the world. When I retired, I realized I couldn't let go of that legacy, but rather wanted to share the passion, the commitment, and the stories of those men and women that call themselves game wardens. This is Game Warden Wayne Saunders, and this is Warden's Watch.
Warden's Watch, episode 44, Conservation Officer Matt Holmes, New Hampshire. Matt Holmes and I enjoyed a ride down to a fundraiser for Operation Game Thief and AIM New Hampshire. Just a good time. Community policing is so important among game wardens and fish and game across the nation. We start working with youth usually at a young age, setting that foundation, setting up that relationship as far as community policing. And it's just so important to continue that. So when they see a game warden as an adult or even still as a juvenile or as a young person, that they can approach that game warden to ask questions, to just have a good normal conversation and build that rapport. And it starts that community policing then. And it starts that fundamental of the Operation Game Thieves and International Wildlife Crime Stoppers, basically, that they can help us. Good sportsmen and women are needed out there. We are just one set of eyes, one set of ears. You sportsmen and women are force multipliers. You good guys are force multipliers. And we need force multipliers. Arizona did a study in the 70s, and it decided they actually had a game warden going out there and putting up evidence for people to report. And they figured about 1% of poaching got reported. 1%. So they would take roadkill and make it look like a crime and place it out in areas where people were and see how many times it got reported. Pretty interesting study. Like I said, it was done back in the 70s, so I'm not sure how current it is, but when you come up with 1% of poaching gets reported, that is just unbelievable. Unbelievable how much we miss. And we probably wouldn't have even one, you know, the portion we catch without sportsmen, because that study was designed to have people in the outdoors that are recreating report. That was the whole purpose, to see how many of these incidents got reported. And it was 1%. It just blows my mind every time I talk about that. There was also a study done in Wisconsin, if I'm correct, where opening morning, they interviewed hunters, some violators, some not. So it was a waterfowl season, opening day of duck season, early shooting happened. So they interviewed the people that didn't early shoot. And a lot of them said that they knew the game warden, they knew his reputation, and they wouldn't want to put him in a position of having a bad reaction to what they did. They didn't, because of his reputation, because his link to the community, it wasn't a direct link. Sometimes it was a friend of a friend of a friend, or they knew his reputation. Those were the people that said they didn't violate because they didn't want to put the game warden in that position. They didn't want to violate because of that relationship and the reputation of the game warden. So that's how important community policing is. I'm sure John Norris, if he was here, he would be backing me up 100%. John, the fall is a busy time even for a retired game warden. So John will be back with us, I hope, next time. He's off on an excursion. John's got a lot of adventures left out in the field, working with his knives, working with Thin Green Line TV. Just a lot of irons in the fire for John, and it's awesome. I've really enjoyed having him working with me. It's just been a great relationship. It's great to have that Western influence, and he's a very dynamic individual, and it's been an awesome partnership. So I hope you've enjoyed it as well. I certainly, when he's not here, it feels like there's something missing. For the continuation of Warden's Watch and the Thin Green Line podcast, we're going to try to do as much as we can together, but every now and then, you may hear John by himself at some point. Remember, report wildlife violations, and that's including fish. I always knock off fish. Hunting seasons this time of year, please report the crimes you see. Game wardens are looking for credible information for cases. So the state that you hunt in, be aware of their Operation Game Thieves hotlines, their wildlife alert hotlines, their turn in a poacher hotlines, the tip lines. There are so many different ones out there. So if you're in a state, find out what that phone number is. And then if you don't know, International Wildlife Crime Stoppers, go to their website. They can provide that information right on the website for you. So you can look at a state that you're hunting, click on it, and that's how to report wildlife crime. Has the whole U.S. and Canada on there. Please do that. Also, support your Operation Game Thieves and International Wildlife Crime Stoppers by being a member. If they have membership like International Wildlife Crime Stoppers does, you can be a member of International Wildlife Crime Stoppers by just a very small fee that helps game wardens internationally and focuses on North America. Thanks. Enjoy Matt Holmes. I always do. Matt and I worked, as you'll hear, very close together for a long time. He's a dynamic individual, a great game warden, and we're going to have two parts of this series, which I'm looking forward to. We have some current events that Matt's going to talk about on the second one, and we'll hopefully get Bob Mancini in on that as well. Sit back, enjoy. Thank you for listening to Warden's Watch. So today's interviews with conservation Matt Holmes. We got a pretty awesome day ahead of us. We're in Matt's cruiser, heading down to a fundraiser for Operation Game Thief and AIM. AIM is Academics, Integrity, and Marksmanship. It's a youth program on shooting sports, which I like to shoot, even though I'm not that great at it, and Matt likes to shoot. And we've been involved in a lot of youth things, Matt, through the years working together. We both, I think, have a passion for the younger generation and passing on our knowledge and doing the right thing to help that.
Absolutely.
We've been teaching hunter safety for how long together?
Been 11 years now, I believe.
Yeah. And you have those people that have those skill sets that actually can do things like that and have a passion for it. So we go out of our own way. After I retired, I'm still involved with hunter safety and still getting those people out and giving them the certification to be able to hunt and fish
and passing on that knowledge, working with the Barry camp, doing this AIM program. I think that that's a pretty cool thing to get kids involved with shooting sports, don't you think, Matt?
Absolutely. You know, they, you know, are showing, you know, motivation to do something, you know, outdoors. And if we can help, you know, bring some extra little bit of excitement to that and encourage them, I only see good coming from it.
Right. And just the AIM thing, academics comes first, you know, and then integrity. And I don't think we hear enough about integrity. You know, doing the right thing all the time and making sure everybody perceives it as the right thing. And that just, it says so much to throw that in a name of something, because we need to have integrity, especially as conservation officers, as law enforcement. We need to make sure that we put that out when we're dealing with people and dealing with animals and everything else we deal with, that we have that integrity. That's something I think is good to put in a name, don't you?
Absolutely. You know, in our line of work as game wardens, you know, your integrity is your meal ticket. You know, if you lose face with the court and with the public, you're essentially useless. So we live it every day and see the benefits of it. And if we can encourage that with the next generation, it should be part of what we do.
Certainly for young people to start embracing that, especially if they want to be game wardens or in law enforcement, that's what I tell them. Keep your nose clean. You know, that's the biggest important part as you grow up, to keep focused on what you want to do in the long run. Whether it's you want to fly fighter jets or you want to be a carpenter or anything, it's still your integrity is really important in almost everything you do, and you carry it with you. Matt and I go way back. Matt is one of those trainees that I had that sticks out in my mind. And day one that Matt's working with me, your first day on the job, you'll never forget that, will you?
I will not. My first day in uniform ever as a New Hampshire game warden, I was slated to work with Wayne. I'd been on a rescue the night before, and after coming off that rescue, driving home, I started to hear a noise in the front end of my cruiser. And I'm not a mechanic, but it definitely didn't sound good. I called Wayne up. And I knew we had court, you know, right off the bat the following morning. So there was a lot of need to, you know, maintain a timeline, meet when we say we're going to meet. And I explained to him this noise. He did a little legwork and said, well, you know, we've got a mechanic here at the shop in Lancaster, which was about an hour from where I lived. Said, just get it up here. We'll take a look. I put my mind to it that I was going to get it up there.
And I remember distinctly making those calls and saying, yep, just limp it up here, Matt. We'll have Kevin take a look at it when you get there. But then I also remember the next call when it came.
So the following morning, I'm headed north to the meeting point, and this noise is getting progressively worse. And again, you got to remember that this is my first day ever in uniform. This is a big day. You know, it's really kind of the start of my official law enforcement career. And the noise is getting worse in the front of my cruiser, and the shake in the steering wheel is getting worse. And a prudent person would have pulled over and said, something's definitely wrong. In my mind, all I knew was I needed to get somewhere, and no matter what, I was going to do that. So as I worked my way north, I made it into the town that I was supposed to be in, but not without a line of traffic behind me, people turning around in the street ahead of me to see what that terrible noise was coming at them. I crested a large hill on the south end of the town, and I remember hearing a noise that sounded like a short burst of automatic fire. And as that happened, I watched my front left wheel pass me. And I had enough time to look while the cruiser was still suspended in air and go, that's my wheel. And the next thing I knew, I'm skidding. The ABS light is blinking. The steering wheel is shaking. And I'm skidding brakes on the rotor into the breakdown lane. I just felt the world was coming apart. I threw on my blue lights. I looked in the rear view. There was already blue lights behind me. I was basically a deer in the headlights going, I can't believe that just happened. And now what's going to happen after this? So it happened that a state truck trooper was behind me. And he jumped out, and I'm sure very quickly recognized the fact I was brand new. He said, "Hey, why don't you get on the radio? Call this in." He said, "I'll go and try and find your wheel." I didn't know anything about repeaters at the time. I was close enough to use a direct channel to the office, but I didn't know that. So I got on a statewide repeater and got a hold of the secretary from our regional office and just said I needed a tow truck. And she asked me if I was sure. I said, "Absolutely. I just lost a wheel off my cruiser." And she said, "Well, we'll send somebody right up." This having gone over a statewide repeater, the big boss in Concord heard it. I think everybody else who was in hearing range heard it. There was no secrets. This is back, you know, 15 and a half years ago when information traveled significantly slower than it did now. So if you had an issue, you actually had time to triage it and do some damage control before things got bad. The cat was out of the bag within minutes of this happening. As it turned out, because I hadn't made the meeting, Wayne, you'd headed to court already. And so I'm stuck roadside, beat red in the face, believing my career is over. I'm like, "Well, this is great. I've worked for this my whole life. I just spent a pile of money on an education to help get me here and made it through the hiring process, and I'm going to get fired first day in uniform." And as luck would have it, we had a deputy working for us at the time named Chuck Jellison. And Chuck had retired after 27 years from state police. He was a troop commander. He was the best person that could have ever shown up, because with that many years of state service, he'd had mishaps aplenty and knew that it wasn't going to really negatively affect me down the line because of the trail of calls I'd made ahead of time. And so he was the best thing that could have happened, because he did a really good job calming me down as we drove across the county to find Wayne, who in the meantime had been called out of court to say his trainee had crashed and was headed in the complete opposite direction. That was kind of our introduction to each other.
First day that neither one of us will ever forget. Boy, no, for sure you won't. I just, I could still remember hearing that you lost the wheel, and I could see that tire, picture you watching your tire go past you and going, "Oh my goodness." And the pucker factor, because all of us have been trainees, all of us have started as game wardens, or if you've started a new job, it's the same type of thing. You have a horrible thing happen your first day on the job, and the pucker factor is, yeah, it's over the top. It's just over the top, and you couldn't have said it better, Matt. That is just, it's just crazy.
It now makes for a great story, but...
All those after the facts make for great stories.
That's right, yeah. And I remember sticking my head through the door at the office, and this is after I came through the door. People are whispering, "He's here, he's here." Concord's on the phone. And so, again, it just... it had my blood pressure maxed, and I stuck my head through the door, and you're smiling like the Cheshire Cat, and you're like, "Hey," and I'm like, "Hey," and I remember you saying, "Hey, you're going to learn how to do a report today." I figured as much. That was that. So.
Yeah, it was happened, and actually, we couldn't figure out why Matt's cruiser was loose. The lugs were loose on his rim. And we did some checking around, and other cruisers had loose rims as well. His was probably the first to come off, but eventually, so one would think that maybe at that rescue or something that you guys were all at, somebody took and loosened up the lug nuts on quite a few of the cruisers we had. So sometimes that happens, unfortunately. Not everybody's a great guy out there, for sure. I don't understand why people do that, especially when they're emergency response vehicles. You could be really hurting somebody else by damaging a police cruiser. Yeah, it just doesn't make any sense to me.
It doesn't. And, you know, fortunately, my lost wheel didn't hit anybody, but that was essentially a missile.
Yes.
It was 100 yards down in the woods beyond the edge of the road. In hindsight, it could have killed somebody coming the other way, especially if they were on a motorcycle.
Yep, absolutely. So people, especially young people, don't have a tendency to think that far ahead. But I want to get something straight, Matt, right off the bat. You're not from Maine.
Because... I am not from Maine. So according to other people, I have an accent. You know, I don't notice it, but it sticks out. Much like Wayne's laugh. Mm-hmm. He can't hide, and I can't hide either because of my local dialect. But for the record, it is local. I'm a fourth-generation New Hampshireite, and it's completely NH, no Maine involved.
And which town are you from?
I'm from Warner. Warner is south-central part of the state, just a little bit northwest of Concord. Even though I've lived elsewhere for a long time, Warner will always be home and where I'm from.
Yeah. I think you're saying it too fast. I remember you distinctly going, Warner, New Hampshire.
That's right. Because there's also a Warren, New Hampshire, and Warren has a rocket in the middle of the town. So when people are getting to know me, they're like, oh, you're from the town with a missile. I'm like, no, I'm not.
I'm from Warner.
That's right. No missile in my town, just a big mountain.
Yeah, and one thing I will tell Matt, I was very, very, very impressed with your typing skills as a trainee, and so much I'm making my kid doesn't even have to take typing in school. Can you believe that? I'm making him type so to learn how to type, and maybe by the time he's in needs it, he'll be talking to everything. But your typing skills were off the chart. I was like, my God, that kid can type. Oh, and there's a reason for that, isn't there?
There is. It's pretty ironic because Wayne knows it firsthand in that I am an old-fashioned man in a high-tech world. And there is very little that I gravitate to with technology. As luck would have it, my mother taught typing. And so not only did I get it in school, but she kept a very watchful eye over myself and my brother and made us learn to type. Like a lot of, you know, life's lessons. It was no fun at the time, but man, has it paid dividends since.
Oh, there is no doubt. No doubt that just jumps out at me. The other thing that jumps out at me as a trainee is making you drive code 3. Because if there was anything that made Matt uncomfortable, it was driving with lights and siren. It was a whole different Matt driving. He would tense up. I mean, just ultimate, you know, attention, hands 10 and 2, and all focused on driving. And when I say code 3, he's not really going code 3. he might be doing 65, 70. That was Matt's code 3. I'd have to tell him to pick it up every now and then. But that was one uncomfortable thing. I always remember we had a head injury on a mountain. I'm like, we got to go code 3 to this. And, oh, I could tell you didn't like that. And,
yep.
That was, and still to this day, I'm sure you don't like driving code 3.
I don't. So, you know, code 3 is kind of our highest level of response, where it means, you know, get there as quickly as you possibly can. And my first times driving code 3 especially were, you know, an absolute train wreck. We got there, but it wasn't pretty. It was a lot of hard on the brakes, hard on the gas, was anything but fluid. Just one of those things kind of out of my comfort zone, and if I can avoid it, I still do. But those early ones especially were memorable.
And on the flip side, Matt, is when we got on an ATV, I distinctly remember we were going up this the road that over in Stark, actually, Roberts Brook, right? Ran right along Roberts Brook, and there was a washout there that was substantial. It was like, you know, probably 6-7 feet straight down, 6-7 feet straight up. And I think I said to them, like, we can't make that. We'll have to turn around. And you were like, no, we can make that. And you just don't even wait for me to answer. You just scoot straight down this thing and straight up the other side. And I just remember going to myself going, oh, now I got to do that. That sucks. And I did. I was much like the time flew ahead me go off the cliff on the border with my snowmobile. I was like, oh, crap, my skis are already off. And he's like, oh, just give it a little gas. And I'm surprised I didn't crash because of you guys.
So we all bring our own skill sets to the job. I guess that's an important part of being a game warden. You know, you don't have to be the master of anything, but it helps to have a few tricks in the bag and be able to learn. I had grown up with a family who were, you know, best friends who, in, you know, hindsight, did a whole lot of violating on ATVs. But we didn't know any better at the time, so we were along for the ride. They had, you know, four-wheelers that we rode until, you know, they all but fell apart. And through that, I learned to ride. And it's still, you know, part of my comfort zone to this day. That was just one of the ways in which I could try and keep my head above water as a trainee.
Yeah, no doubt you were highly skilled with an ATV. And you just don't expect that for Matt. That was one of those things that kind of popped out. He doesn't like to drive Code 3, but, man, he can scale a dirt bank that's almost vertical, which just blew my mind. I didn't see that coming that day either. But you're definitely right. Everybody brings their own skill sets, and that's what makes a district or anybody, you know, a good group. If you have different skill sets and you can bring it to the table. Glen, with his building aspects, has been a huge resource. His father came in and helped us build additions onto our pole barns, and just certainly have had a lot of guys like that with skill sets that can all jump in and help. But there's a guy that has that set that we just rely on. Oh, and I think that's true with most game wardens. We're called the Swiss Army knife of law enforcement. I remember being in a training and the guy's like, who has 100 feet of rope in their cruiser? You know, quite, you know, it was about half the class raise their hand. Okay, who has 200 feet? And then, you know, it gets down a little. We got the 500 feet, and I was the only one with my arm up. He goes, why do you have 500 feet in your cruiser? I said, we're pulling moose into the woods. Yeah. And he's like, wow. I said, and then I told him, I got from our local mill runs of paper machines off this rope, and when it's done, they give it to us, and it's still pretty substantial in pulls. And yeah, I got about probably 500 feet, maybe even more in my cruiser. Because it becomes useful. So Swiss Army knives with law enforcement. But definitely, Matt brings his woods knowledge to that. And he's very, very good in the woods, to the fact that your personal plate is still, is it still woodsman?
It is, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, and you grew up in the woods, and you got very savvy in the woods, and always good. And hunting and fishing, his skill levels are pretty impressive, especially when it comes to investigations. What's one of your most memorable investigations, Matt, you've had?
There's certainly been a variety over the years that have, kept my attention. But one of my favorites still to this day involves several people in a local town who were poaching deer. Basically, the case was made off a photo in the newspaper and DNA. And that was a really, really good one.
You still have that photo kicking around?
It is probably buried in the bowels of my office somewhere.
I'll have to track that, because that was it was one of those photos that just stirred emotion and anger, just all kinds of things.
Yeah. And it was emotion and anger that really solved that case. So just going back to it, this was pretty early on in my career, and one of the nice things about being early on is that most guys are super gung-ho, and I was no exception to that. It all started with a call late in the deer season from a local police department saying, hey, there's a tarp thrown over a bank next to the Israel River in town. It looks like there might be a deer leg sticking out of the tarp. And so I went down and investigated it, and it turned out to be parts and pieces of multiple deer wrapped up in this tarp. And in our area in New Hampshire, there's very limited opportunity to shoot does legally. At least three of the deer in this tarp were does. The chances of them being harvested legally were slim to none. And so myself and Wayne and Mark Ober kind of pieced through the parts, and ultimately I took the heads that were present, and I took them to a local veterinarian who x-rayed them for me for free, and they all had 22 bullets in them. You know, fragmented up, you know, were pretty much indiscernible when you looked at the heads, but under x-ray, you could see that there were bullet fragments in there. So, you know, it kind of confirmed all our suspicions. And aside from that, there was very, very little physical evidence. Nobody had seen the dumping occur. I think it had snowed between when the tarp had been thrown and when it was discovered. And try as I might, you know, there was nothing to go on. And a 22 bullet in general has very, very little value ballistically, aside from getting a caliber. So I hemmed and hawed and, you know, kind of, you know, just chased down leads, but, you know, failed to, you know, develop anything substantial. And so ultimately, the decision was made to put a photo of these deer carcasses in the paper. And at the time, it was not exactly risque, but it was not widely accepted to try and put a picture of butchered animal remains in the paper.
And it was the worst picture you ever saw, because it looked like it was one mangled thing, because it was all frozen together with deer heads sticking out and deer legs. And it was just, I don't even know if you could count the deer by looking at that picture. It just looked like there was 50 deer wrapped up in a ball, and it was the most, it was the most emotionally disturbing picture. And we got that on the front page, didn't we?
We got it on the front page. We had crafted the article to highlight the fact that there had been a shoddy butchering job done on these deer, and that a lot of, you know, very good meat had gone to waste because of the way they were butchered. It elicited a response immediately. Even people amongst the community who were suspect number one were irate. And they weren't irate because the deer had been poached, but they were irate because the deer had been wasted. And it got the community talking in a big way. And it took, I want to say it took a week or two. I ultimately received an anonymous call, and I think it came in through a message. I remember it was a day off, and I ended up calling the person back, who happened to be a local woman. And as it turned out, she partied with some guys on a regular basis who loved to get drunk and go out at night and shoot deer. I arranged to meet her. I remember we found a out-of-the-way location behind a building, me and my personal vehicle, and she met me. We had a coffee, and she laid out this story of a couple local yokels who would get drunk and go out at night and shoot deer. And not because they needed the meat, but because they enjoyed doing it. One of them was somebody who was pretty well known to the PD. And the other one was an unknown guy who originated from Vermont, who was essentially squatting in a house in Lancaster. That started the whole investigation.
Yeah, it started. It gave us a lead, and, you know, Operation Game Thieves are so important. I think, again, that's kind of key, getting those pictures. We offered a reward with that, didn't we?
We did offer a reward. Yep.
So give somebody that normally wouldn't have the incentive. But certainly, looking at that picture and seeing those deer angered people. And I think that was more about getting the information we got than it was about the money. It was about, hey, this is out of control. Even to those people that, whether they approve of a poaching or it's accepted, you know, they know what they poach, they eat. So there's different layers of poachers, or different levels of poaching. There's those guys that just do it for fun to kill, which even the poacher that shoots them and eats them doesn't like those people. So it's different. There's a respect among somewhat thieves, so to speak.
Absolutely.
I hate to say that, but there are different levels. Don't you agree, Matt?
Yeah, there are. And it's kind of goes back to criminology, but there absolutely are. And the community in which a game warden works, you know, the sporting community, is still a small one, even though there's, you know, hundreds, if not thousands, of people that participate and will come in contact with. There's a lot of relationship building, trust and lack of trust that goes into our job. And kind of goes back to the old saying, keeps your friends close and your enemies closer. We certainly do that in the game warden world. Try and be available when somebody's pissed off at another person and is ready to, so to speak, drop a dime.
Yeah, or when they really hate one game warden and they like the other game warden.
That's right. Good cop, bad cop.
Has happened with us, huh, Matt?
Yeah, it has.
Matt's kind of a likable guy at times. I'm sure Matt has a few that don't like him, but I can certainly know a few that don't like me and would talk to Matt. And go out of their way to talk to Matt.
We, that's a whole nother story.
That's a whole nother story, but... Yeah, so anyways, getting back to this one, I mean, you developed enough information for warrants, and not just one, but several.
Yep, we ultimately, through basically a confidential informant, got enough probable cause to get search warrants. And we did it for three residences. We believe there was meat stored at two of the residences, and then the third residence had a gun. That was supposedly the gun used in these killings. We executed all three warrants almost simultaneously.
Yeah.
The both residents that we thought would had meat. I think we got some dope out of it. I remember at one of the residences, there was a bowl behind an illegal owl mount. you know, the kind of stuff you just can't make up.
No,
you know?
No.
Usually, you know, people who are out night hunting aren't doing just one thing wrong. They're doing a bunch of things wrong. And those search warrants highlighted it. Basically, the people we were dealing with had been through the system many times before. Ooh. So they weren't going to give anything up. You know, I remember them telling us, oh, that's not venison, that's pork. Just lying like rugs. Mm-hmm. Certainly, they weren't the types that were going to break on an interview.
And these are interesting places that we search. They're not your normal, typical household. I mean, I remember going, one had outbuildings, barns, and the house was in disarray, and you're trying to go through and find evidence. It was nice to see the owl standing out there. But definitely, you know, a challenge to search for things, but that's the nice thing. You got to keep meat in the freezer. So that's one thing we need to get into is those freezers and to find the meat we found. And then, yeah, to tell us it's pork when generally we can know that this has been hand-packaged. Yeah. And that's always pretty good to go to. So, but, yeah, just to give them a lay of the land, you know, that we're searching. We got local PD involved. Yeah. We had state police involved, too, hitting three places simultaneously. We need all the help we can get. And a lot of the stuff, the drugs stuff, that we hand off to the local PD or the state police as we find it. We can prosecute it, but it gives them part of it and actually splits up the case a little and makes it a little handier for everybody. So everybody gets a piece of the illegal activity, and we all work together, local, state, especially when there's numbers needed. And doing, I know a lot of people that have listened to Warden's Watch have listened to some of the coordination it takes to pull off a search warrant simultaneously, because you don't want the phone going, especially nowadays with cell phones and social media.
Yeah.
To get that information, you got to really hit them and hit them simultaneously. So that's so important.
And at the time, we were dealing with scanners a lot.
Yes.
And I can remember that the third residence had a scanner right on the porch. Mm-hmm. And they were absolutely listening into the goings-on. So the level of secrecy needed, you know, have a successful warrant was right up there. And in this case, it worked out well. Because the suspects were playing hardball, I ultimately sent samples of the meat collected from the freezers to a forensics lab at the University of Maine. These were matched with samples taken from the deer and the tarp. Took a while, but I remember the samples coming back, and the odds of it being anything but matching deer were like 1 in 3.5 million. Mm. And there is far less than 3.5 million deer in the state of New Hampshire. Mm. These particular individuals, you know, playing hardball right up to the day of arraignment, when they were presented with the evidence, I remember one telling the other, he said, hey, we need to go smoke a cigarette. And I said, go ahead, come back. And they did. They decided that they'd just plead guilty. And so there was a deal struck where instead of being charged for every charge we had, which was a significant number, they got charged, I think, for a couple deer apiece being illegally taken. And kind of one of the silver linings to that was, although these weren't huge charges, both these individuals were indigent. They spent all their money on drugs and booze and had nothing. And so they actually both ended up doing time for these crimes, basically to pay off the fine amounts owed. So at the end of all this, the bad guys actually did go to jail. And as I like to tell people, jail usually doesn't serve pills and beer. So at least not easily. That's what really hurts these guys. You know, they're addicted to to physically not be able to intoxicate themselves is a huge punishment. I think it turned out as well as it possibly could have.
Yep, no, I would agree. It was a really good case that took a lot of time and a lot of effort. I mean, just packaging up the DNA the way it has to be and shipped off to the lab and then wait for those results, work with the lab, calling and talking to the people doing the process and then getting those results back. Yeah, no, I think it's one of those cases that came, you know, all the way through. You find that bunch of deer dumped over the bank and you start your investigation. You start collecting your evidence. I mean, first you had to thaw all those carcasses out. That was an achievement in itself.
Which December in northern New Hampshire is not easy.
No. Oh, it took a lot of work and a lot of time pulling those apart, dividing up the animals, taking all the samples, making sure you got enough samples of them so we could later on hopefully do DNA just like you did. And mitochondria DNA, it's just like humans. That's game wardens do basically the same thing that's at a homicide when we see a deer that's been poached. We collect the evidence, we take the scene, we photograph everything, we collect all the DNA we can, and we take a ton of pictures because that scene's never going to be the same again. And we go back and look at those pictures and see if we've missed anything along the line. We do a quick sketch if sometimes, or we do a big sketch depending on what the scene looks like. Certainly with a fatal ATV accident, snowmobile accident, it's a very detailed report that goes into a fatal, and the same goes into investigating all of these all of these crimes. I think I still have that picture of you, Matt, all suited up in your white outfit, your white painter's uniform, doing a necropsy on a moose.
Yep.
Yeah, that was great, and that's what we do. And that moose actually died of natural causes that I have that, but we are able to determine that. I remember one of the first moose that I went on, big, huge bull. Me and Mike Moody did a nice necrops on it, and it had been in a fight, and it broke a rib, and it stabbed its heart. It was the weirdest thing. You'd never thought that, but you have to peel back the layers, the hide, the meat. You have to get into those ribs and figure out what is it, a bullet that killed this animal, or what killed this perfectly healthy moose. And to see that rib that broke and stabbed that heart, it's just like, wow. And the power of another moose to do that. This was a very big moose. That's pretty good. So great, great case. Certainly took a lot of hands doing it, but you were certainly the lead guy on that and pulling all those deer apart. So that was that's one of my most memorable cases too, because of the heinousness of it.
That was, you know, a really fun one, very rewarding. And cases like that also help you as a game warden when you're going through a dry spell. Because like any job, you know, you have highs and lows, and you can work really hard some seasons and not come up with much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, along those lines of rewarding cases with multiple hands on deck, do you want to talk about the Success Moose case, the double kill with the out-of-staters?
Yeah, no, that's another good investigation. Oh, that took a lot of effort and a lot of work.
So, again, going back some years, the moose hunt in New Hampshire, since its inception, has been a big thing. Back in the mid-2000s, our moose population was very high. The state issued a lot of permits, and especially for those of us working in the northern region of the state, you know, moose season was just as important, if not more so, than the beginning of the firearms deer season.
Yeah, it was our busiest season back then.
We just burnt the candle at both ends, as you'd say, going day and night, kill site to kill site, you know, investigating double kills and all kinds of other stuff. We had another egregious scenario in which a cow and a calf moose were both shot and left on the side of a logging road known as Success Pond Road. This road is used by hunters, fishermen, loggers. It's really got a big presence in the outdoor community in the region. I can't remember if it was a logger or another hunter who ended up seeing the legs of the moose after they bloated and started to stick up out of the grass. Do you remember who that was?
I think it was another hunter, another moose hunter found them. I'm pretty sure that was, thinking way back, I'm not really sure, but I think it was another moose hunter.
So these moose got discovered and we got called. That first day I was on scene, we did a necropsy, just like we were talking about. Mm-hmm. And it was very obvious both moose were shot. Well, in a carcass the size of a moose, it takes some doing to find a bullet. You know, we're using metal detectors, we're using knives, and we're, you know, systematically going through this entire carcass. And at the end of it, we came up with two bullets. One was 30 caliber, and I think the other one turned out to be 7 millimeter.
Mm-hmm.
And again, we, you know, we put a story in the paper because we didn't have any ready-made suspects. And it gained a lot of attention, but didn't produce a lead. New Hampshire's moose hunt is 9 days long, and that zone had a high success rate. And this discovery happened kind of at the beginning of the hunt. So we, as a group, developed a plan that we were going to basically saturate the area and try and locate every outstanding moose party who hadn't been successful.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of that, there was only one moose party that was not identified as having returned to hunt the second weekend of the season. And it's a big thing to get drawn for a moose permit in New Hampshire. So, you know, if you do get drawn, you're putting in some time and some effort. Like, it's very uncommon for permittees to not hunt both weekends unless they tag out.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had one group that didn't show up, a father and son.
Yep.
And they were from out of state.
And you had those bullets identified, and one was very...
One was, fortunately, very was very unique. So I took both bullets to a local gun shop, whom I knew the owner of. He took one look, and he right away said, without looking, I can tell you that the smaller bullet is 30 caliber, and it was fired from a Marlin Model 336. He said, oh, really? He said, absolutely. He said, the Marlin Model 336 was one of very, very few production rifles that used microgroove rifling. And so that microgroove rifling is immediately apparent once you know what to look for on the base of the bullet.
Yes.
All we knew was we had that, which was very specific, and then the calipers revealed that the other bullet was 7 millimeter.
Yeah.
And at this point, we determined that the father and son are from Massachusetts.
Right.
You bring up the point that in Massachusetts, you basically have to have a paperwork trail to own guns.
Right. They have to list their guns that they own on their paperwork.
Right. So. And not only that, but we have a couple places where Mass residents usually buy their guns.
Yes, we do. So we first checked out to find out that those guns weren't on their list. Well, made some calls down there. They weren't on their list. But that's when we got thinking, well, where would somebody from Massachusetts buy firearms? In New Hampshire or Maine? And we have a big firearms dealer right over the border in Maine that it gets a lot of action and gets a ton of people from Massachusetts and New Hampshire that go there to buy or purchase firearms. And I happened to have a contact there. So reaching out to him, asked him if, you know, ran the names by him, and he was like, yeah, they bought a 7 millimeter and a Marlin
Model 336.
Model 336. And I think I finished the sentence, microgroove. And he was like, yeah. Putting that case together, and father and son, the son had the 3030 microgroove, but developing that case out of Massachusetts, bringing them back, and once you throw all that evidence, I think just the fact when you bring those people back, it's they already know.
That's right.
I remember that interview wasn't that tough.
It went very well, and I think what it came down to was they saw these two moose. Father and son get out of the truck and had a very brief conversation, both shot at the same time, and both shot separate moose.
Yep.
And instead of doing the right thing and calling in and saying, hey, we screwed up, they said, we got to get right the heck out of here. Mm. And to kind of further the story, there had been a vehicle seen in the area that nobody could really identify as coming from a particular group. It turned out that Dad didn't own a vehicle, and he'd rented one. And so, you know, even by description, we couldn't trace a vehicle back to the father because he didn't own one. He had just rented it.
Right, right.
So
that was tricky.
It all came together, and we got a lot of positive feedback from that one. And like I think I told you at the time, it was... For locals, it was the perfect villain because they were people from out of state, where I guess wherever you're from, anybody from away is
right.
is instantly the prime suspect. You know, they'd committed this egregious act of wasting, you know, two of, you know, the local moose. The case was made.
Right. And you make a great point, Matt. It's just own up when you mess up. The easier you work with us is the easier we work with you. When you make us jump through all kinds of hoops, in the long run, it makes it harder for us to work with you, whether it was an honest mistake or not. I always remember out in that same country, a spike bull that was shot and left during the moose season. And the spikes were just barely beyond the ears. So mm-hmm. it was probably a legal moose, just by maybe an inch or two. Well, the guy freaked and went home to New York. And I remember sending the New York wardens over there to do an interview because, again, we're looking at who's hunting in that area, who has a cow permit. And they knock on the door, and the first thing he says out of his mouth is, I've been waiting for you. Because I remember saying, how'd the interview go? There was like, it was real easy because knocked on the door, and he opened the door. He goes, oh, I've been waiting for you. You know, just, again, just work with us. We'll work with you. Honest mistakes happen. It's when you start hiding things and start going the other way that it just, we have to treat it differently. So that's what those Operation Game Thieves, we've had several call. Yep, I shot a doe and it's bucks only. Go out and you treat those people the best you can because we need honest people out there. We want those people that'll turn themselves in because that means they'll turn somebody else in.
That's right. Everybody makes mistakes. And it's just, like you say, how you deal with it after the fact.
Absolutely. You know, I always look at that moose picture of you, Mark, Doug, and Mike, the many moose that was killed over in Cedar.
Yeah, triple kill.
Yeah.
Three moose killed and only three shots fired. Those guys turned themselves in, and, you know, they kept one of the moose and were treated very well. You know, typically moose violations in New Hampshire come with a two-year loss of license. We got it knocked down to 1 year. They paid the butchering costs of the other animals. The meat was donated, so it didn't go to waste.
Right.
Yeah, you want to talk about a pucker factor. We actually discovered the third moose while we were investigating the two that were known. Those guys all but fainted. It was, again, another example of how, you know, how you act after the fact, you know, determines your fate.
Right. It's funny because that's one thing during the moose season. We used to have a lot of double kills because sometimes bulls are together and one will fall down and the other might be bedded, so he stands up. So in your mind, the moose that you just shot, you know, is still standing there, and you put another bullet in it and you walk up and you find two moose. So it happens. It happens to some of the best hunters us have known. And it's just make that call, because when the game warden happens to be out there checking a kill site or something and finds double moose, then we start that investigation. It certainly, I don't know how many of those I investigated over the years, Matt, but it was over a dozen, I bet, because I can flip through my mind to different scenarios. I found myself yelling at the TV the other day. I was watching Meat Eater on Netflix, and the guy shoots the moose, and he goes to shoot again. I'm like, don't shoot, don't. And my kid looks at me. I'm like, oh, they wouldn't put that on TV anyways, Andrew. And I had to tell him the scenario, but instantly. And you get some guides that'll do the same, because once they, you got one shot, make it count, because that second shot, we're not going to let you make it, because it's just, it's so prevalent, and it happens. And then your mind plays tricks with you. Because of the scenario, I've had deer shot the same way. A guy shot three deer. Well, the ones that were bedded kept standing up. He thought he was shooting the same deer. He gets over there, there's three dead deer. And that's got to be a pucker factor, too.
Oh, yeah.
Well, anyways, moving on. Geez, just a lot of things. I want to go into search and rescue, which I know you have a lot of those stories, because I've made some of those stories for you, unfortunately. Me and Glenn talked about the night you and him spent out in the pouring rain that I asked you to stay up on the mountain. Yeah. Because I was like, you guys can hike like an hour and a half out, but you only got like 3 hours till morning.
Time has softened it, Wade. You didn't ask us. You told us.
Okay, so. Yes, I told you, yeah. Yes.
Which was the right call, because, yeah, we were 4 miles up. That's just one of those scenarios that you can't make up. In that case, a college professor and his wife separated while coming down off of Mount Madison. She made it out and he didn't. Kind of to preface this story, that particular year, I'd actually been on another very mild rescue just hours before that. And it went extremely well. It was a simple walk out on a very easy trail. And I remember thinking as I was driving home, like, man, like, I have been through this whole year and I haven't had to spend a whole night out yet, which is practically non-existent in our world in the North Country search and rescue scene. And I didn't make it to the end of the road I was driving on before I was getting called to this Mount Madison one. And it was raining and
torrential downpours.
Yeah, the weather had turned miserable. And so Glenn Lucas and I are working our way up this trail. We've got volunteers in the area. At one point, we're hollering. We get a response. We think we've got them. It turns out to be AMC volunteers, which we figured out through radio communication. Mount Madison is just a long mountain. There's no short way to get to the summit. Just a couple hours before dawn, we make it to treeline. At treeline, basically there becomes a jumbled rock slope above you, and this extends for a long, long way. And it's not in an area that can be searched effectively unless you have daylight. It just can't. It's a spot where somebody would seek shelter and they can hide and be, you know, completely out of sight within feet of you. And so once we get to this spot, we make radio contact with you. You tell us to stay put. Glenn's grumpy about it. I'm like, well, we're here and I don't want to hike all the way in and out anyway. We had gear to spend the night. And so we decide we're going to bivvy up for a couple hours. But before we do, we shine our lights around. We holler the name of the guy we're looking for. No response. So we bivvy up. And I remember telling Glenn I didn't know if I was going to be able to sleep or not right about the time the first snore erupted. I can also tell you that after 2 hours of laying on the ground, even in good gear, I was shivering violently when the sun came up.
And it wasn't that cold.
It was not. It was about 50 degrees.
Yeah.
So that was a really good reality check. So we get up at dawn and continue searching our way up the mountain. Once we get towards the summit, we hit an intersection where some other hikers are at. And we describe the gentleman, and they said, yeah, he just went that way towards what's known as the Great Gulf. And so we basically go jogging after him and ended up catching him. And it took the vast majority of the day to actually work our way out with him. He turned out to be okay, which was a miracle because he had limited gear. But kind of the bullet point of the story was that, you know, we told him about our efforts to get him the night before. And he said, oh, was that you guys shining lights and hollering my name a couple hours before dawn? Mm. Like, yeah, sure it was. And he said, oh, man, he said, I thought I was hallucinating, so I didn't respond back. He was sitting 100 yards away from us on the rocks watching us, listening to us yell his name, and he thought he was hallucinating, so he didn't respond.
Yeah, crazy. Crazy, 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 crazy. Yeah, no doubt. What's your worst search and rescue? Can you pick that out of the top of your head?
That one's actually easy. So the worst one I've ever been on was for a gentleman named Ed Bacon. And I don't mind using his name because it's highly publicized. And it was basically just the perfect storm of misery. The only thing it didn't have was cold temperatures. And it's a good thing because otherwise somebody probably would have died. But we had this fall storm predicted that was going to be so bad that the White Mountain National Forest was going to shut down. And that doesn't happen for anything short of a significant natural disaster. Been well publicized, bad weather's coming, stay away, the forest is shutting down. There was a hiker from the Midwest named Ed Bacon who decided he was going to go anyway. He was not in good health, not well prepared, and he got hit by a storm and basically trapped near the summit of Mount Lafayette. And Lafayette's a pretty imposing mountain. It's got absolutely terrible weather. It's very popular. I personally dislike the mountain more than I can say. So several crews of us had to go up after this guy. And during the time we were out, over 5 inches of rain fell on us. If we jumped in a lake, we could not have been more soaked. We got hammered by high wind, stuff that was knocking us to the ground. It got very, very hairy. One of our most strong team members on the search and rescue team was hypothermic. We had to get him warmed and back in a better position. When we finally get to this guy, he's a big man. He's over 200 pounds. And carrying somebody that weight is hard enough amongst other things. Never mind the fact it's coming off a mountain and we're about 5 miles from the road. And it took forever. He became pretty surly while laying in the litter. He got in a verbal altercation with multiple members of the team that had come to get him. Trickles that normally existed were raging rivers we had to rope across. Tension grew between members of Fish and Game and some of the volunteer search and rescue community who had different opinions on how to deal with things. You know, fights almost broke out. And at the very end of it, somebody diverted us on a shortcut, a member of the crew who was carrying, and we ended up off trail having to bushwhack down to the interstate. And it was just the coup de grace as far as, you know, the misery factor.
Wow.
And still to this day, if somebody said you could only finish your career by doing that again, I would probably call it because it was that bad. If I never go through anything that miserable again, I'll be just fine.
Yeah. No, that was, yeah, I wasn't on that one. You were out of the area, and thank God I was a lieutenant, but I have heard from many of the wardens and the volunteer search and rescue members that was that was horrendous. And sometimes it has to do with the patient too. Just their attitude can turn everything sour. If people are very happy, and generally they are happy to see you, yep. I can't even imagine. I mean, I've dealt with a few of them, but even not to that extent, Matt. Even the most angry people are usually somewhat friendly and are somewhat thankful.
That's right. In this case, we received none of that. Mm. And it was just absolutely miserable. There's been colder rescues and harder rescues. In the totality of things, that was by far the most miserable.
Yeah. And people, when it talks about these search and rescue missions, you put people in a litter, and then you carry them down a trail, and you put them in the middle of the trail that's designed for people to go in single file. So basically, both rescuers on either side of the litter are walking on the edge of the trail, which is eroded, usually slippery. It's hard and difficult to begin with. And then you throw going off trail, bushwhacking. I can't say I've ever done that on a rescue, Matt, because that's mostly, you know, you get to the trail and you go. It's very rare that you have to go off the trail. But
it is rare, and we were just flat out looking for some sort of relief at that point.
And it got worse.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know a lot of us lieutenants map out those shortcuts that actually work in the long run. that's great. I feel like we got so much more to talk about, Matt, and we're getting somewhat close.
We are getting somewhat close. I think we're going to have to shift our focus to shooting.
Yeah.
So
we'll come back, though, on our trip north, I hope, and I certainly want to talk about, you know, Northwood's Law. Before they air your accident you just had, too, I was hoping we could talk about that.
We can talk about that as well.
That would be good. Although, I must say, I'd like you and Bob Mancini to get together sometime, because you and Bob have had some memorable times. I don't know if I'd ever try to put you guys together, because you seem to be that vortex of serious incidents.
So the last day we worked together, we talked about that. We had not worked together in about 3 months due to the crash I was involved in. Really, we were both involved in. And that subject came up. So that'll be more stories for another day.
Oh, my goodness. Yes. So you guys are the Bermuda Triangle of the North Country when you Matt Holmes and Bob Mancini together. Somehow I think we're the Bermuda Triangle because we seem to have a lot more incidents.
We do. Yeah.
We can talk about some of those. So we'll get to this AIM competition, and hopefully we'll have a good show in here today. Hopefully I'll be able to pull off some good shots. Been practicing a little. Oh, and I've seen you shoot 30-30 like nobody's business. I remember just after qualification, Matt took out his 30-30 at the end of the qualification because he hadn't shot it yet that year. And he shot a can, and I think you hit it 5 times as it was moving and kicking it up the bank. And I was like, wow. And you've killed a lot of deer with that firearm, haven't you?
I have. You know, I'm a huge proponent, as both a game warden and a hunter, of using a weapon that you've got confidence in.
Yes.
And for me, that's it.
And you've had that weapon for a long time?
For a long time, ever since I was 13.
Oh.
And it's done its job well, and again, I use it like an extension of my arm.
Yes, and it certainly is like that. I told Matt he should bring his 30-30 down to this trap shoot, and he'd probably do better with that than he will with
a shotgun.
I
probably will with a shotgun, yeah.
Well, that's awesome. I'm looking forward to this event, and that'll be cool. We'll catch up with you later.
Please join me, Game Warden Wayne Saunders, and other Game Wardens on our adventures, protecting wildlife, saving lives, and having fun, all while serving the public and the natural resources of our planet. Listen to the tales and experience of those who work in the outdoors while being entertained with stories about encounters with poachers, wildlife investigation, murder investigation, near-death experiences, search and rescue missions, wildlife interactions from Game Wardens around the country and around the world. When I retired, I realized I couldn't let go of that legacy, but rather wanted to share the passion, the commitment, and the stories of those men and women that call themselves Game Wardens. This is Game Warden Wayne Saunders, and this is Warden's Watch.